allow me to recount a gripping tale set in the future that could be just around the corner. Our story begins with an exciting discovery made by a Russian scientific expedition in the distant reaches of Siberia's northern permafrost. The remains of a female mammoth, preserved for an astounding 22,000 years in the icy embrace of Saiylyk, a remote mining village. As if the rising temperatures alone weren't enough to thaw the frozen ground, it would be the industrial complex's excavation and drilling that would disturb the eternal slumber of this magnificent creature. This perfectly preserved mammoth, as later revealed upon examining its stomach contents, had tragically met its end during childbirth on an indeterminate spring day. Amidst the members of the expedition, a large group of workers and technicians from the mine would also bear witness to this recovery effort. Many of them would assist in the excavation, perhaps without taking necessary precautions, touching, pushing, and pulling with bare hands. Inevitably, accidents would occur and their blood would come into contact with the fluid seeping from the thawing carcass. These fluids were contaminated with spores of microorganisms common in the Paleolithic era, but utterly alien to our immune defenses. Enter the so-called patient zero, a technician who right after the mammoth's exhumation would hastily board the company bus to the nearby Yakutsk airport, aiming to fly to his family in Novosibirsk, a Siberian city of 2 million inhabitants. During the bus ride and the subsequent crowded commercial flight, he would start sneezing and coughing. By the time he reached his destination that evening, he would have come into contact with at least 100 other people. Feeling unwell during the night, he would seek medical help at the nearest hospital in the morning. Tragically, after just 3 days, patient Zero would die horrifyingly in front of countless bewildered and utterly powerless doctors. The aftermath, as you can imagine, would be all too familiar. Headlines, alarming reports on the contagion's effects, a frantic race against time for science to develop an effective vaccine, disbelief giving way to sheer horror, and ultimately, an apocalypse. No, this isn't the plot of a poorly made disaster movie. It's simply what might happen as early as tomorrow. Let's dive into why this is happening. Global warming has long been associated with the emergence of new health risks, mainly due to the migration of tropical diseases to temperate regions like Western Europe. However, more recently, we've come to realize that another threat may arise from the far north, where millennia-old microbes could be unleashed by the rapidly thawing Arctic Siberian permafrost. Permafrost, it's a term we've become familiar with over the years, particularly through accounts of prehistoric animals perfectly preserved in Siberian ice. Approximately 15% of the northern hemisphere is covered by permafrost, some of it millions of years old. Explorations into the microbial flora of Arctic permafrost began long before media interest spiked. As early as 1912, the presence of bacteria in Siberian permafrost was known, and by 1944, we understood that these bacteria could survive in such conditions. This research, primarily conducted by Russian scientists, remained overlooked by their Western counterparts throughout most of the 20th century due to the Cold War and language barriers, with much of the Soviet researchers' work published in Russian journals, not distributed abroad. The term permafrost, introduced in 1943 by American geologist and paleontologist Simon Muller, refers to permanently frozen soil layers found at depths of several meters below the surface, particularly in high-latitude and high-altitude areas. Permafrost consists of a rich mixture of decomposing organic matter with a diverse population of microorganisms, providing ideal conditions for preserving cellular structures and DNA. It's cold, dark, anoxic, and neutral, the polar opposite of the factors that rapidly destroy surface microbes: heat, UV light, oxygen, and extreme pH levels. Below the active layer, the absence of water halts all metabolic activities, killing off most microbes. However, some of these organisms can enter a dormant state called cryptobiosis, allowing them to revive under suitable conditions. This applies not only to single-celled microorganisms like bacteria or protozoa, but even more so to viruses, which don't require any metabolic activity to maintain their viability. Deep permafrost thus becomes a permanent repository of ancient microorganisms and viruses, dating back as far as 1 million years. But that's not all. With the thawing, prehistoric bacteria and viruses are also released and reactivated, some of which may still be contagious and resistant to modern antibiotics. In the oldest permafrost layers, mummified bodies of mammoths, reindeer, woolly rhinos, and even humans can be found, with their frozen bodies live bacteria, viruses, and spores cryogenically preserved for centuries or even millennia. Not all of them survive intact, but a small percentage of these organisms withstand freezing, and with climate change, they can even reawaken and come back to life. It's not just a hypothesis. These organisms indeed exist, have been discovered, and thoroughly examined. Scientists with a macabre sense of humor have dubbed them zombie viruses. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. The identified viruses so far, around a dozen, date back tens of thousands of years. The oldest, dating back 48,500 years, is a giant virus called Pandorovirus eudoma, found buried beneath a lake. While other viruses have been extracted from various sources, including the fur of a mammoth and the intestines of a Siberian wolf, all entombed in permafrost. In laboratory experiments, when brought into contact with single-cell organisms like amoebas, these viruses demonstrated their ability to infect them. Naturally, as far as we know, no one has dared to experiment with human cells just yet. But in permafrost, not only ancient viruses reside, many more come from relatively recent epochs. For instance, a lung sample taken from a woman's body exhumed in 1997 from permafrost in a village on the Seward Peninsula, Alaska, contained genomic material of the influenza strain responsible for the terrifying 1918 pandemic that claimed 20 million lives worldwide. In 2012, mummified remains of a woman buried in Siberia 300 years ago were found to contain genetic signatures of the smallpox virus, a disease we managed to eradicate only at the end of the last century. An even more alarming episode occurred during the 2016 anthrax outbreak that struck dozens of people and thousands of reindeer in Siberia. It was caused by the rapid and profound thawing of permafrost during exceptionally warm summers, allowing old Bacillus anthracis spores to re-emerge from ancient human burial sites or animal carcasses. Epidemiologists offer reassurance that we can reasonably expect ancient bacterial epidemics to be controlled by modern antibiotics, despite the discovery of antibiotic-resistant genes in permafrost. Antibiotics are broad-spectrum drugs, likely capable of dealing with diseases like plague, anthrax, legionellosis, typhoid, tuberculosis, and salmonellosis. However, antibiotics target bacteria, not viruses. This is where a prudent and pessimistic line of reasoning arises. As unfortunately documented by recent pandemics, each new virus, even if related to known families, almost always requires highly specific medical responses, such as new antivirals or vaccines. There is no equivalent of broad-spectrum antibiotics against viruses. Hence, it's legitimate to ponder the risk that ancient viral particles could remain infectious and resurface due to the thawing of ancient permafrost layers. Thawing permafrost thus exposes us to the danger of confronting diseases that have decimated a significant portion of the human population in the past, without any guarantee that current vaccines, developed for epidemics no more than a century old, will be effective against older strains of viral diseases like smallpox, pneumonia, meningitis, influenza, or even the common cold. The real peril of this situation is the possibility of humanity encountering a virus not only ancient, but so ancient that it is entirely unknown to medical science and our immune system. This actually happened in 1519, when Cortez and de Alvarado's Spanish forces landed in Mexico. A few hundred men managed to topple the Aztec Empire, not only thanks to firearms, but also the diseases the Spanish brought with them upon their arrival. The conquest of the Americas marked the greatest biological warfare in history. From Columbus's second voyage onward, Europeans brought an endless list of diseases to the New World. Smallpox, measles, plague, influenza, salmonella, scarlet fever, and chickenpox. The death toll after half a century of devastation was immense. From an estimated population of 15 to 25 million, excluding South America, only 3 million survived by 1550. The reason for this devastation? Quite simple. For the Amerindians' immune defenses, the viruses brought by the Spanish were completely unknown, proving to be deadly and highly contagious. In that case, it was a lack of antibodies due to the long geographic separation between Amerindians and Spaniards. However, in the near future, the triggering factor could be the viruses belonging to the far distant epochs. The human immune system may not be adept at handling pathogens from the past. Our immune defense has evolved slowly through close contact with the environment we've developed in. If there's a virus hidden in permafrost that we haven't encountered for thousands of years, our defenses might be insufficient to combat it. Is there anything we can do to avoid falling into this trap? Certainly. Stopping the thawing process and addressing the current climate crisis and its roots are the best options to prevent these biological threats from escaping permafrost. Scientific knowledge makes its way through a rapidly changing world, and research on the Siberian viruses is only the beginning of a long journey. Combating the awakening of millennia-old microorganisms require constant attention and proactive preparation. Only through a better understanding of these ancient pathogens and coordinated global action can we hope to contain emerging threats. The true challenge, therefore, lies not only in discovering these zombie viruses, but in how society responds to this new reality. Scientific discoveries must be approached with caution and awareness, but also with courage and determination. Only then can we protect our world and future generations from these silent yet deadly threats lying within Siberian ice. The time to act is now.